It's our time now. That's the reality. It is our time now to get a peace. We don't want half of the cake of England. We don't want half of the parliament. We don't want half of the government. What we want is a fair share of the cake. Stop taking the whole cake out and not giving us none. We want some. We're entitled to it. We have paid for it. We have sweat for it. We have died for it. We have bled for it. It's about time, and that's really where it starts.
It soon come. It soon come. Look out, look out, look out.
Harlesden, the London borough of Brent. Over half the population is black or Asian. Unemployment is above the national average. In 1981, a group of youths wrote a report on the realities of life on their high-rise estate, Stonebridge. They hope to create a new life for themselves and for their community.
In real terms, the redevelopment of Stonebridge has been a disaster, incorporating all the problems associated with high-density, high-rise development.
To be no more than a huge dormitory. The streets in the sky have proved
menace,
to be a menace.
An escape route for muggers and a playground for children who have nothing better to do.
Stonebridge has been a disaster, incorporating all the problems associated with high-density, high-rise
noise transmits unhindered from one flat to another. One presumes that
a community for 7,000 people without any amenities? Did they really imagine that people?
But rather, pressures to be realistic about financial costs which changed
the system. That now 80% of the people in the area are of West Indian extraction.
Blacks, whites, and Asians view each other with considerable suspicion and sometimes outright hostility. The Asian community see themselves as a prime target for violence.
The gang was always together, and I think we wanted to have a sense of that, you know, you watch the movies and you want to be a gangster, but reality, we were living like, well, we call it paper gangster lives, and you know, it's not really real, but you got to keep up to it nevertheless. You got to keep up to the fashions, you got to put money in the pocket. People were drifting in and out of prison, so the group came weaker, or another moment it became stronger.
When you're a teenager, it's like we're saying, when I'm 25, you know, I'd like to have this, and I'd like to have a big house. You'd like to have everything that costs money. But we weren't thinking about how you're going to sort of really, you know, prepare yourself to be able to earn money legitimately. And at the time, school education for us, well, I don't know, but my school days weren't really that.
They wasn't doing nothing for us at school anyway. They was just teaching us about Columbus, who was just a liar and a thief, and teaching us about all these people who was just evil people and making them our heroes, you know. So that was just rubbish. We didn't know nothing about ourselves.
Yeah, I think it dawned on me when I realized that my dad was a jack of all trades, but he specializes in carpentry. He was getting peanuts really for what he had put into Britain coming over here 30 odd years ago. And I realized that even though I was born in this country, there was no way that I would have slaved out my guts to build up this country, because I knew really what they had to offer, and which was just keeping blacks at the bottom of the pile.
We agree with that, you know, that all our parents sort of went through that, and that in itself made it, we were saying, no way, you know, are we going to go through that kind of thing. No way we're going to sort of go and work and find that we can't meet, you know, the dreams our parents had, the dreams we've got. We're sort of just going to fall into the same thing. We weren't into that. But what was happening around us at the time in 81 was grim. The 13 people that was killed in this fire at Lewisham, that again sort of raised consciousness in people's minds, you know? And there was a strong feeling about doing something about the situation that we were in.
Almost everybody had to sympathize with the loved ones of the injured and the dead. For this year massacre, make we come to realize it could have been me, it could have been you, or one of few we picnic them who fell victims to the terror by night.
In April 1981, following a campaign of aggressive saturation policing by the Special Patrol Group, Brixton erupted. By the summer, rioting had broken out in many of Britain's inner cities. In Liverpool, Manchester, Leeds, Coventry, Sheffield, Nottingham.
Our children are suffering. They are crying for help. Nobody will listen. Nobody wants to take notice. They are not.
Understand how anyone can read the Bible and yet they don't believe in the second coming of Christ, and when he shall come, our sorrows will be ended. When he shall come, no more crime. When he shall come, no more distress. When he shall come, no more crying. Praise God, the Bible said the former things are past, and behold, all things become new.
81 is a crucial year for me because my brother and myself decided that we wanted to start living outside of the area, or trying to develop something outside of the area, because there weren't nothing happening around here. Everybody was just going to jail, and it was just a no-go situation.
If you worship the building, Jesus is coming. If you worship Jesus, he's coming again.
So I started to develop something outside until I learned I was doing something within the area, and I was forced to really come in and try and see what I could do. You know, it was only right for us to tell the youths where you're going, where you're coming from.
Because I was out there in the wilderness, and out there in the wilderness I seemed to be ashamed of coming to God. I felt embarrassed if people spoke to me about being good. And these were the things that I felt were totally out of my life. But then coming and finding God, which my parents was dealing with God before the day I was born, I can turn around today and feel happy. That no, I am not weak because I turn around and say that I want to follow God or I want to believe in God. I believe that I am strong because all of those who's out there who are still lost, all they do is find themselves every day in the dark corners because it's a blind alley they're going down. And until they see the light and open up their eyes, they will not know when they are starting to go in the right way. I ask if we can pray for all of those who are still lost.
And I think just the result of the riots, even before it came about, we were saying, let's try and do something in our area. You know, it's very limited what we can do, but once we start talking and start trying to channel a lot of these energies into something, we must get something off the ground.
One of the main things we campaigned for was like a club or a disco for people, young people to go out in the evening. There was no sporting facilities around the place in the area. There's no cinema, there's nothing in the area for people to do.
You could mug, you could pick a purse, you could just hang loose, gamble, smoke weed, get drunk if you had the money.
I mean, youth hanging around in the streets and being harassed a lot by the police. There were a lot of complaints going on. So the tension was building up and was there.
Just walking around, talking to people, it was just the motivation to try and get people to start doing more constructive things with their lives.
The group of youths from Stonebridge formed themselves into the HPCC, the Alsden People's Community Council. Their headquarters on the estate became a meeting place for unemployed youth. But on the streets, the tensions of the summer of 1981 had reached Stonebridge.
I just happened to actually be outside at the time, and I noticed a lot of skinheads. It was actually skinheads who actually came over at the beginning. And were trying to round up people to go rioting. And one came into the club and, you know, other people came out to see what was going on.
The club was just so packed. It couldn't hold no more. And outside was becoming packed. And there was this guy running up and down with a chopper saying he wanted to chop up a bull. And there was people coming up with pickaxes. And they just had all different things. And I'm saying, yeah, you know, it's like them serious.
I went up to one of them and I said, what's the plan then, you know? Hear what he had to say, and he said, you know, we got to go and get him. And I said, who? And he said, the police. And I said, where are the police? You know, he said, out there, we got to get them before they get us.
Because I'll tell you something, the community workers, them who was a so-called community worker, were telling us to go home. You know, these were the people, they was telling us to go home. They was telling us, we can't do nothing. Leave them, they're gonna riot, get yourself out of trouble and get yourself. And they're supposed to be doing the job and keeping these people from rioting. I couldn't understand that, you know?
I don't know, something happened then. I just turned around and started saying to people, look, you know, don't go following these people, because at the end of the day, it's going to be, you know, blacks running right in the streets, not whites or black and white youth, it's going to be blacks running riot in Harleston.
Because what we were saying is, like, we started building, right, and we don't want to destroy what we build, right? We just started doing something. And if we mash up Stonebridge, we're going to have to look at it tomorrow morning, you know? If you're going to riot, go up Armstead, go to the country, go where these people are okay. When they come in their back garden, it's like 20 acres, you know? Go to their place and riot. Them are the people, you know? What are you mashing up your own place for?
Watts, suburb of Los Angeles, California, 1965. Over 1,000 injured, 34 dead. Damage estimated at $40 million. The Watts riots changed the course of the black struggle in America. The man brought in to rebuild Watts was a labor organizer and former construction worker, Ted Watkins. Backed with money and resources from his union, Watkins founded WLCAC, the Watts Labor Community Action Committee. Message: construction, not destruction. WLCAC harnessed the community into a massive program of self-help. Shopping centers, hospitals, garages, and homes were built for blacks by blacks.
What is the real answer is getting people involved in work and doing something about the way that they live, the environment, doing something about the houses that they live in and building those houses, doing something about the business that's in the community and owning some of the businesses and seeing to it that the businesses are protected because they have a share in owning them.
In 1981, Ted Watkins was invited by community service volunteers to report on the riot-torn inner cities of Britain.
On my first visit to London, I went on a tour of Brixton, Hackney, Haringey, and Brent. And in Brent, I visited some youth who were in a community room playing ping pong and snooker, and asked them if I could talk to them about some of the things that we were involved in Watts with youth. They agreed to let me talk to them. When I finished my talk and slide presentation, they gave me a standing ovation and began to hug me and kiss me on the cheek. And that night when I got in at 8 o'clock, there were six of these youths sitting in the lobby of the Russell Hotel waiting for me. And we began to discuss how to go about setting up youth employment opportunities, youth training programs, and youth beginning to become masters of their own destiny. And since that time, I have made frequent visits.
By the end of 1981, HPCC put forward its own program to Brent Council to move from the confines of the small center on the estate to an enormous disused London transport bus garage. This was to be the way forward. The main shed of the bus garage would be transformed. There would be workshops for small businesses, a sports hall, music studios, a bar, and a restaurant, all managed by the HPCC and supported by Brent Council, or so they hoped. From the start, it was not an easy alliance.
The council never come to us and say, do you want this idea? Do you want to do these things? No, we call the meetings, we got the people. When I say we, I'm talking we the people. When we done this, we came to the council, and that was after we set up classes with voluntary workers, English classes, maths classes, electronics classes. We were running these without advice from them or nothing. They must have thought we wanted some Mickey Mouse youth center or youth club to run around and play ping pong.
Brixton is not that far away from us. I think the council responded positively because they saw a community here that was suffering very many of the same problems, but responding in a different way. And the council wanted to do something to show its support for that. So again, the bus depot was there, and the council quickly agreed to purchase it.
To buy the freehold of the bus garage from London Transport cost £1.8 million. The money came from Brent Council, the GLC, and the Department of the Environment. Brent Council defined what the HPCC's role was to be. It was to develop the complex. But they were only offered a temporary lease on the site. The person appointed by Bren Council to advise the group was the assistant to the chief executive, Richard Gotch.
I remember one occasion when I was working with the group in the early days, and I had written some chapters of a draft feasibility study. And I'd really gone on a bit too quickly and had started putting down a whole lot of my own ideas. And at an early meeting, they were very critical. And we had quite an argument because they felt that I was running away with the project. And I learned a great lesson that day, that it was important to make sure that everything in the report was their ideas. And it wasn't my job to impose ideas on them.
The bus garage is what HPCC has worked for.
They decided what was going to go into the bus garage. They decided how it was going to be run. The philosophy was that it should be run by the local community, that local people should be trained to run it.
The HPCC's plan for the bus garage was ambitious. It was likely to cost more than £5 million. In a well-publicized fundraising effort, the group went to Brussels to get help from the European community. In September 1983, with further support from the GLC, the Department of the Environment, Bren Council and others, the project moved into phase one, the conversion of the old administration block of the bus garage.
I think the project actually started to grow because there was all these people that could use it, I suppose, for their own ends politically in the aftermath of like inner city disturbance. I suppose there was also a lot of money floating around at the time that they had to consciously get rid of, you know, and we can sort of do something for the ethnic minorities. Looking back at it, it was as if they were actually interrogating us, you know, to see what we were made of and what we were all about. And how comes you people, you know, how comes you had this idea of... And it was just a simple thing as need.
I think this is a pretty remarkable and individual project, and I don't think that you can sort of say, let's have them all over the show, because it's very dependent on a particular group of people coming forward, seeing a need, seeing an opportunity.
The image that was portrayed was a big movie star, a jet set. He moves around, all photographers flashing, all newspaper reporters moving, and he's just shifted, 5 minute wonder. If his presence down here can actually help the situation, we'll have him down here. But we ain't humbling ourselves to anybody to say, well, okay, my lord or my master or this, the only one who gets that is God.
With much pomp and ceremony, the mayor of Brent opened phase one in December 1983. From the start, phase one was a success. Unemployed school leavers enrolled at the Information Technology Center, where they took courses in computing. The new creche was used by working mothers and single-parent families from the estate. As the project grew, the staff increased. It was felt that managerial skills were now needed. In 1983, a young college graduate became the first black professional to take a leading role, Mike Wilson.
I knew of the area from having lived in the area for quite a bit and worked in the area for quite a bit. And the sort of things that were going on in terms of the community, I wasn't involved in that because of my own beliefs. Whereas other people had been involved in crime, had been in prison, been thrown out of school. So I knew exactly what I was actually getting involved in that respect. Although I knew that, for instance, in the very, very early days, I wasn't involved in all the major decision-making, I think why I became co-opted onto the council was the fact that I produced a report November 82, which looked at the structuring of the organisation with a view to giving some direction about how we ought to develop.
Under pressure from funding agencies and Bren Council for a more sophisticated approach to their accounting, the HPCC was forced to recruit a white professional, Tony Adams.
I was asked to go along there by a friend who was one of the founder members of the group. He came along and said that the project needed someone with a bit of experience who was prepared to teach. My title was financial coordinator, and that meant that it was my responsibility to set up an accounting system for the project.
Can I just hand those minutes over to Rog? Have we approached people like the Lord's Taverners or anybody like that?
No.
I think they do give money for
for what they consider worthwhile, you know, recreation activities.
With a management structure acceptable to all the funding agencies, phase two of the project could now begin. It was to be one of the biggest community centers in Europe.
Yeah, well, you can see that. The main area, that is all this, right? You've got the little rooms. Yeah, what we're going to have also is like these pillars coming out, and we're going to have it like into a sports hall, and it's going to seat 1,000 people. We're also...
To keep the project under their control, members of the Alsden People's Community Council chose to appoint their own architects, their own surveyors and engineers. It was a decision that proved costly.
By the time they got down to the detailed costings, it was about 5 million. And quite frankly, it seemed that whilst the local authority had been motivated into getting the bus garage project for the black community, I think that perhaps then Brent began to think that the price that they were being asked to pay was too much.
Like, we've got stage A, B and C, which is the project itself, building wise.
The plan was drawn up in close consultation with the people of Stonebridge. This was to be a building for the people, by the people.
Okay, if you look here, right, you can actually see where the sports hall is going to be, right? It's going to be beacher seating, but it's going to actually seat 1,000 people. Here we've got the administration unit.
We were concerned that, right, we've appointed our consultants, they've interpreted our brief, they've designed a building worth £5.8 million. It was more than what the funding agent said they were going to contribute, therefore it left a funding shortfall. Nobody, least of all us, wanted to see a building go up that we wouldn't be able to have the funds to complete.
There then began a programme of undermining the architect by saying that he should not have produced what the black community wanted. He should have produced something which was more reasonable. Eventually, turned out that the architect was asked to leave the project. I myself felt that he was given a bit of a raw deal because the man had only actually done what the HPCC wanted.
Coming in from an entrance that will be there, at the far end we're going to have changing rooms.
In real terms, what it did was it probably put the project back a year or 18 months because all the plans, I think they paid somewhere in the region of £200,000 to the architect to produce these plans, were in fact all thrown away, and they decided to rethink the whole design and the whole concept of the project. So that was one area where the local community were not getting what they wanted, but what the local authority wanted them to have.
When they want us to succeed, you know what they'll say? Oh, it costs that. Needs that? ER. The same way how they deal with anything they're doing. Anything. If they're going to build a youth centre, if they're going to build a club, if they're going to do... They ain't going to put quarter or three quarters of the money. They're building it. That's what they want to start doing. They want to start being real.
Faced with the rejection of the original plans and the depressing prospect of an 18-month delay, the group organised a visit to Ted Watkins in Los Angeles, California.
We can't come back, you get no more, we get no get time to go.
When we went to the States, we went to Hollywood, Beverly Hills and all these places, which was a dream for any young person growing up in this. They make Walt Disney sound like, hey, you know, when we were growing up, these things were big things. Now, we never even thought the day would come when we would really go out to these, but it was a dream.
Close your eyes! He's undressing!
But we ended up going out there for business purposes, to go out there and see a similar black community group.
We learned how they've actually taken on board a whole community environment and changed its whole shape. We've seen so much out there that could be achieved, and I'm not saying that it's exactly the same as here, because obviously we wouldn't be able to just duplicate to what's over here.
Have you got any words for HPCC and the people that wish to support HPCC in its development? And could you also say anything if how they could actually help to develop themselves?
One of the things that I think that we have to understand that HPCC is an infant, a baby, 20 years younger than the Watts Labor Community Action Committee. It will have all of the growing pains, all of the problems, all of the mistakes that WLCAC has had if they last 20 years.
Our eyes were open to where, if we're dealing with black people and the development of that, where people are in society. And in America, you know, there's black politicians everywhere, and it's as if politics is crucial. It's part of the key to their development and their representation and being heard and stuff.
Okay, we're ready.
All right, my name's Julia, and I'd just like to say thanks to the Watts Labour Community Action Committee and all the funding bodies that made it possible for us to be in Los Angeles, California.
From Juliet?
From Juliet.
From Leonard?
He's not Juliet, is he?
Spontaneous.
I was telling you to say from Juliet.
Yeah, but I've said my name already. You know what I mean?
So thanking you from Juliet.
On their return from Watts, Juliet Simpson, the only woman on the HPCC board, left the project for personal reasons. There were more setbacks to come.
How that all basically started was that a blank check was signed, and what the finance coordinator at the time asked for this to be done because the signatories on the account, this is about March 85, would be away at a two-day conference and the payroll need to be run.
It was probably a situation where the finance officer was interrupting a meeting and saying, I've got to pay this bill, can you please sign the check? And I'll fill in the rest. And something like that happened.
Come July 85, we were instructed by our bankers the 19th of July that a certain sum of money, £50,000, had been cleared out of our account in favor of a company which didn't really register in my mind at the time when it was told me by the bank. And that, did we know anything about it? Had we authorized it?
At the moment, I myself am involved in litigation with the project, where we had the use of some of the project's money, we're having difficulty in getting that money back to the project.
I know people who just wanted to do something to the man. We stopped them doing something to the man because they thought that he took a liberty, an out and out liberty.
In September of last year, Tony Adams and another member of staff, Roger Barnes, were charged with the theft of £50,000 from the HPCC. In his defense, Adams claimed that Barnes gave him the £50,000 to invest for the HPCC on the Zurich commodities market. Adams expected to make £7,000 profit from the deal, of which he hoped the HPCC would let him keep half. The plan unfortunately went wrong when the money was stolen at London Airport before Adams could catch his flight to Zurich. The jury believed Adams and Barnes' story, and both were acquitted. The £50,000 is still missing from the HPCC.
That was a real low point. Certainly very depressing to come back from leave, as I did last summer, and to find the first note on one's desk to say that £50,000 has disappeared from the project, because you know not just that it's serious matter that £50,000 has disappeared, but that that's going to undermine the support of all sorts of other agencies for the project itself. And so you have to go through a difficult period of trying to recover that support, trying to ensure that that doesn't happen again.
From now on, Bren Council would look after the appointment of architects and contractors. The council would have final approval of the plans for phase two. The Harlesden People's Community Council had lost control. The new plan was an exercise in cost cutting, from nearly £6 million down to £3 million. This time, the people of Stonebridge were not consulted. The HPCC was forced to change its priorities. The Porto cabins on the site now housed a finance department, a training department, a business department, a personnel department, a legal department, arts and culture. There were meetings about meetings, reports about reports. The bus garage was turning into a paper project.
All the staff here, it's uppermost in their minds that on the one hand we have the conflict of the funding agent saying these are the things that we've given you the money for, we want report backs quarterly even as to how things are happening, and yet there's the other end, you've got a community saying, well look, you've received all of this money to be for the benefit of the community, what's happening, we don't know, etc. There's a constant pull on people like us in the middle of that to actually meet the needs of the funding agents as well as meet the needs of the community. And indeed, the community has lost out in a sense in that respect, because the people who were moving around as activists within the community in year one have found themselves propelled into this sort of structure where they've been having to produce all these reports, etc.
In October 1985, the foundation stone for Phase 2 was formally laid. But by now, a rift had developed between the HPCC and the people of Stonebridge it was meant to serve.
It's a bit far away, it's a bit far-fetched from us all, really. It's like, it's just remote, you know? It stands off from the people, doesn't stand with them.
It's supposed to be for the people as far as I'm concerned, but I haven't seen anything constructive come out of it yet. You know, and that's my personal view, my honest personal view, you know, which is very sad because the needs of the people on this estate is really, really tremendous. We need something constructive to be done.
I'm unemployed and I haven't heard anything from them, and I've been living on the estate.
Just that a lot of us around here don't pay much interest to it. Doesn't seem exactly, there's not exactly a lot of things down here that I'm really interested in.
They do things for people, but it's slow. It's a couple of years they've been there now, and I don't see nothing really happening.
They're not taking enough action. They're not coming out and they're showing their faces. I don't even know who runs that place.
Sometimes when people in the community reach, right, within those certain levels of to operate certain things, say, well, I'm the studio technician here, or I'm what, they change. That's it, in a nutshell, they change, and their thinkings and everything are all towards themselves. They're not, you know, they don't really want to know the ghetto people no more.
If I was up there, I'd see me as another council worker. That's how it goes. You work for the council mould you a certain way, you start talking their language, and you start, even you almost come off with their bullshit, you know, and believe it, you know? But it's not real.
After 4 years of arguing, building work on Phase 2 finally began. In January 1986, Ted Watkins returned to Stonebridge.
Hello, Leonard.
Hello, Tim.
How are you doing?
Right, thanks. You're back.
Back. Right.
You know, we're just going to head in there. I've told Bowler that you're here.
Okay.
You know he's in Community Link.
Okay.
Where's Molly?
She's downstairs, parking.
Did you expect all of this?
On my visit, I'm encouraged by some of the things that I saw. But the major thing that I saw, I'm discouraged by. When I went there, the youth were in the executive positions of running their training programs and running their little canteen and basically running their offices. But there has been approximately a £3 million contract to renovate the bus garage, and there was not one black worker working on that garage. And I think that is one of the major problems that I see there. What we do is bring in a $48 an hour plumber, and we can put a trainee who earns $3.50 an hour with that plumber. That plumber shows that young man how to put that pipe together. The carpenter shows him how to put the studs and do the carpentry work and the framing and all of that stuff. This goes on throughout the project, and what we are preparing them for is the apprenticeship training.
Yeah, I think that's the way to do it, to mix the unskilled with skilled.
So what of the promise of building jobs for the community? Brent Council and the Department of the Environment had put the contract out to tender. They were obliged to accept the best offer. Unfortunately, the successful contractors did not happen to employ many black workers at the site. Once again, there was a conflict of interest between the council and the people of Stonebridge.
Every document and everything that I have seen, the council of Brent is still in control completely of the physical things that are happening. They're in control of the garage when it's completed and when it started. But Leonard and HPCC has the full responsibility for whatever goes wrong without having any rewards in the end, except they are paid hands to see to it that this job is done.
Time is running out for the HPCC. Its short lease on the site has almost expired. One issue matters above all. Who will actually own the centre? The Alsden People's Community Council or the London Borough of Brent?
£36,000 was obtained from the DOV in industrial urban aid. £243,000 was obtained from the DOV in industrial urban aid. Another £75,000 was obtained from the DOV in traditional urban aid. And £700,000 was obtained from the GLC, their capital programme. And Brent put up £746,000, which is well below half the money to buy this site. You see what I'm trying to say? So all of this money has not come from Brent to say that they should have legal entitlement to the site, but they have it. They own the freehold. And here we are, 4 or 5 years later, bargaining for some interest into the site.
People always used to say they will never give us a lease. They'll always be controlling, although the government owns everything anyway. They always anything anywhere
from Miss England.
From Miss England, the government owns it anyway. We've got to be clear about that. But we can have the lease and buy the freehold and control the management structure. But we shouldn't back down. And the way we've been negotiating and have been putting it off and thing, we've got to really get our act together. And I would say before the building is finished, we need to be clear. We need to say this is what we want. Right? What are you saying? And throw the ball in their court.
If HPCC is denied the freehold on the site, it may no longer be able to influence the future of its own community. Since the riots of 1981, money has been poured into the inner cities. When the Stonebridge Community Complex is opened sometime in 1987, the cost will have exceeded £6 million. This project was once proclaimed a model of black participation. But will it now go down as a paper exercise in a Britain where, as far as the black community is concerned, all the decisions are taken in advance and the real power lies elsewhere?
Come on, let's see some practical action. Let's see some serious economical help or aid to blacks and not dependency. Let's not see no Mickey Mouse blacks. Let's not see no imagery, no stereotyping. Let's see the real thing. Let's see real assistance. Let's see it come truthfully. Once you keep lying, you get caught out. And that's where, when a riot comes, they feel like they're shocked, they're surprised. How could this happen? They got to deal with it. If they don't deal with it, then they were forewarned and they didn't want to heed it.
This is the Stonebridge Community Complex today. Most of the essential construction work has been completed. The center is in limited use, but the entire development has yet to be officially opened. Massive funding shortfalls are predicted, and the argument about who will control the center, Brent Council or the HPCC, is still to be resolved. The battle for Stonebridge is far from over.